Okay.
So, Christina, you are one of the, first of all, you work at Cincinnati Human Relations Commission.
Yep.
You are one of the leaders and co-founders of Rethinking Racism. You're a leader with the Black Lives Matter. So, tell a little bit about yourself, something from your childhood.
This is getting deep.
That's what I'm looking for, right?
Yeah.
Something from your childhood that informs, like a memory, you know, just a short little nugget, just a minute or so.
Okay.
That's informing the work that you're doing today in the community, especially on race.
Yeah, so my grandmother is from Alabama. Most Black Americans have stories of, you know, moving up north for the Great Migration to find a better life. My grandmother was married to a man that was in the military, so they moved around a lot. But she used to always tell me as a child that she was a domestic, and I don't think I really understood what race and racism, what impact it had on her life until after she passed and I became old enough to understand that her opportunities were diminished because she was a Black woman. So sort of drawing on some of the oral history that she provided me sort of inspired me to engage more complex conversations around race and racism.
Yeah.
And today is like undeniable to talk about how that impacts our lives.
Okay, great. And when you say domestic, you mean like a domestic servant? Like,
yeah, she worked for white folks,
yeah,
cleaning houses.
You know, when I worked at the United Way, I was taking down the Queen City Club and the University Club a lot, and I didn't miss that everybody in the place was a Black servant, and almost everybody eating there or in the club was a white professional. Occasionally, you know, Ross Love might be there or some corporate CEO type, but I couldn't notice that there was such a great racial divide. There was not a single white servant in the entire place.
Sure, you're probably the only one that didn't notice.
Which was just weird. Well, the University Club is supposed to be the liberal place. That's where Judge Jones was, you know, joined. And I guess, anyway, so we'll leave it at that. So that whole, the idea of domestic and how that was almost like a caste system.
Absolutely.
Okay, got it. So Nick, I know you're a City Beat reporter.
Yes.
So tell me a little bit about sort of what your intention is behind your writing, like what's your viewpoint, and then same thing, what childhood memory informs that viewpoint in your journalism?
Okay, well, as a journalist, I'm not supposed to have a viewpoint, I'm supposed to be objective, but we all know that that's not.
You have filters, right?
Right, yeah. Everybody has a perspective. And my perspective does come from a lot of the ideas that there are a lot of systemic things that cause oppression in our society. And my role as a journalist, I feel, is to sort of break those down, try to show what those are and get people more aware of them. Race is a big one. Immigration has been one that I've been focusing on recently, but also gender, LGBT status, those kind of things. Those are all, you know, very systemic rooted problems that we have in our society. So in terms of, I didn't know I wanted to be a journalist until I was an adult. So I'm not sure.
Did you have a prior career?
I was a musician for a while. I wouldn't call it a career.
I just learned that about
you. Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. I was also a barista for a while. And actually, so
starving artist all the way around.
Right. Yeah. Maybe instead of a childhood memory, I'll tell you about the moment that I started to become a journalist. If that's okay with you.
Sure, sure.
I don't want to change up the question, but
no. Anything that's important to you from that they'll inform
sure.
us.
Yeah, and this also plays into race, I think. So I was working at a coffee shop and a bookstore in Fairfield Township, which is in Butler County, fairly conservative area. And I had this repeat customer who kept coming in and ordering the same drink every other day, pretty much. And one day she swiped her credit card and it said, D.B. Short Publishing. And I just struck up conversation, like, you know, what kind of publishing do you do? Like, what is it? And she did these small community newsletters. Her name was Belina. She is one of the few Black women I met in Fairfield Township. She's from Alabama.
Wow.
She was an engineer before she started staying at home to take care of her kids. And this newsletter was her way of kind of being civically engaged in Fairfield Township. As a person who is a distinct minority there. And so this was her way of getting her voice out there. And I didn't know all that at the time. I was just like, that sounds interesting. Like, what, you know, like, hey, I took some government classes in college, like, what, you know, like, do you need somebody to cover something? I could do that. And she's like, yeah, go to the community council meeting, or it's township trustees, actually, and write something up about it, and let's see what you got. Wrote it up, ended up writing for her for like 2 years. She paid me pretty well. We covered, you know, all kinds of different things, economic development in Fairfield Township, school board, all this stuff that I think made a difference. I, you know, like, it only went out to a couple thousand people, but I think it was pretty powerful. And she kind of gave me my start. I used those writing samples to apply to grad school. I was doing this while I was in an AmeriCorps program. They accepted me, and that was the start of the ride for me as a journalist. And seeing her kind of like get her voice out there and be civically engaged in like, in an area that has some pretty not ideal racial ideas.
Yeah, well, that's Sheriff Jones out there, right?
Exactly, yes.
He's very pretty, generous of
you. He's pretty radical.
Absolutely.
When it comes to his views on race.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
I was going to say, or not.
Right. Thank you very much for reminding me. Right. We're not in our own little bubble here.
Right.
Did she, what was it, Belina?
Belina was her name, yes.
Did she have a social justice, racial justice perspective?
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, also one of the first people I met in Fairfield Township, because I grew up in Hamilton and Middletown is where I grew up, so right around that area. And, you know, I think my parents were, or my mom at least, was always very, like, socially aware and taught my brother and I that. But outside of that, there wasn't a lot of talk about social justice, and she was one of the first people I met outside of my college experience too, who really was like very upfront about it and very open about it.
Yeah.
And I was like, cool, you know? Like,
yeah, right, right.
I'm not even saying that here. This is, you know, this is great. And just the strength that she had in like advocating for these social justice issues, talking about these things was like pretty incredible. So it was inspiring.
So one of my neighbors who couldn't be here, she's having some serious troubles, just challenges at home. So she just was, like, I totally understand. She had in front of her yard, and she's white, but grew up in Price Hill, and so had loads of African-American friends growing up, because she's 35, and so the Price Hill had been roughly diversified by then. So she had a white, end white silence, little campaign, what do you call
yard sign?
Yard sign, there you go, right, yeah. Yard sign.
End white. I saw it in the ground.
End white silence, and I'm like, wow. Her name's Kate Rydell, and I talked to her about it. And she also is the president of our Eco Village, which has, you know, you can't just say it went how it went. There just were never any black folks in the Eco Village, even though there were always a handful of black families on our street, and there were certainly lots of black families in amongst the four or five blocks around us. So some of us had asked my wife and I, and said, well, that's odd, but we never did anything about it.
Okay.
Which we can get to, right? I mean, I'm happy for mea culpas. So, you know, it was acts of omission on my part in the whole Eco Village, but she became the president and said, listen, we live in the middle of a black neighborhood, basically. And so she's been writing about it.
Good.
From President Kate.
Nice.
What, like on the front, and I was a little taken aback, like, ooh, maybe she shouldn't be writing this. Maybe this is too much for the Eco Village. Is the Eco Village about race? You know, and I'm all kinds of left-leaning, racial justice.
Right.
And I didn't think, I didn't like lock on that. I let myself sit with, but I was uncomfortable is my point.
Absolutely.
And I let myself sit with that and then said, well, wait a minute, you know, let's cheer that on. So we talked and I just said, hey, you know, keep pushing. Have people, what have people said to you? And they were, some folks were happy, some folks were cautious. So anyway, just got me thinking about ending white silence. And when I read about and heard talked to Dan Joyner about rethinking racism, and that part of your work is to challenge whites to be responsible and not wait for instructions.
Absolutely.
So I wanted to have you on and have Kate on, but obviously Kate's not here, but you know, a white male is great. So you can reflect.
Get that on a t-shirt.
White male is great. So I just wanted to.
Proud to be the token white male.
I wanted somebody white other than me, that it's not just me talking right about the white, so that you can talk about this. So Christina, just with that as an introduction, tell me what, just talk about that whole issue of rethinking racism and how that whole issue about ending white silence came up, and what you're doing with that issue just anywhere in your life. It can be Black Lives Matter, it can be Rethinking Racism, whatever it is.
Yeah, so Rethinking Racism actually grew out of a contentious conversation that took place at a Faith Community Alliance meeting. So you've attended the meeting before.
Yeah.
Faith Community Alliance is, I would say, the largest consistent group of clergy I've seen in the...
Yes.
That they gather monthly, they give out reports and talk about how to engage in very complex social issues. It was right around the time. So Rethinking Racism started because there was a contentious conversation that arose within a Faith Community Alliance meeting in the midst of discussing Black Lives Matter as a movement. There were clergy who insisted that the stance should be that all lives matter. And there was just sort of this back and forth occurring within a formal meeting that frustrated myself and another individual. Her name was Allison. She was from Intercultural Justice and Peace Center, and when we walked out of the room, we sort of locked eyes. We were like, what just happened here? So we have a group of people who have been invested in social justice issues for decades, so it's clear that there's a commitment theoretically, but the debate that just took place was problematic.
What was problematic?
Particularly, so when people use rhetoric to respond to Black Lives Matter with All Lives Matter, they like to use terminology like black on black crime, an idea that perpetuates the notion that black people are inherently criminal, and we all know that crime is a social phenomenon. People tend to commit crime within their own race due to space and location. And it's also sophisticated, right? When we talk about issues of homicide, robberies, they're often tied to class. So it's when people disengage from the issues that Black Lives Matter as a movement have raised by just saying all lives matter or what about black on black crime, it makes them people who are trying to be unifiers complicit in dismissing the actual problem. So we sort of came up with Rethinking Racism as a way to ask broader questions about why Black Lives Matter would even arise as a movement. So after our first two, we recognized that the group was getting good numbers, but it was just disproportionately white. And people would say, well, what are we doing to get more people of color? And what about African Americans? And what about Latinos? Why aren't they showing up? And then I came to the conclusion that it wasn't our job to show up. We've been showing up, right?
It wasn't African Americans' job to show up.
But. Exactly. So right now, if we look at Biden and the sexual assault campaign that's taking place on college campuses. It's called It's On Us, and it's a male-driven campaign that tells men they need to step in to stop sexual assault, stop rape culture, don't participate in misogynistic behavior, make it clear that you will not accept certain behaviors because men are ultimately more influential in the lives of other men. The same premise is true when it comes to destroying things like racism. People of color, even with the most well-intentioned white folks, tend to be silenced in their critiques of structural, individual, and institutional issues. So it's important for white people to take it personal and act out against systems of white supremacy.
So let me put that in a way that just struck me. I will often say to people, as a professional facilitator, mm-hmm. It's like the president of an organization, don't facilitate your own meeting, because they look at you and they think, you got a stake in the answer, right? And so you're going to manipulate the room, even if unconsciously,
right,
to suppress other voices. So have an independent person, then you need to be part of the team, and so you can really listen in here. So it's almost like African Americans are standing up in front of the room and saying X, Y, and Z about racism, and white folks kind of tune that out a little bit.
Yeah.
Say, well, wait a minute, you got skin in the game.
Yeah.
No pun intended, but so you have a perspective, and so we're gonna, like, you know, to have a filter for that that's different than,
yeah,
no, I'm white, and you shouldn't be saying that stuff.
Yeah.
You shouldn't be racist. You shouldn't be doing X, Y, and Z. just like a male saying, if somebody's like Billy Bean. In an ideal world, Billy Bean would have said to Trump...
Bush.
Oh, Billy Bush, not Billy Bean. Billy Bean is the baseball guy, right, in Oakland. Yeah, Billy Bush. Billy Bush should have said, hey, man,
it's
not funny, man. We don't joke about grabbing people.
Yeah.
Anywhere.
And that could have been it, right?
Right,
it doesn't take a dissertation.
Yeah, it doesn't take a lot. So it's... How do you react to what Christina says as... But she's putting it on you as a white person.
Absolutely. I mean, it's my job, not just literally as like a journalist, but also as like a human being who happens to be a white male. You know, like, I got to stand up for other human beings. And at this point in time, other human beings are not being listened to the way they should. And I am, because I'm a white male. So it's my responsibility to use my voice in whatever way I can, you know, to use the privilege that I have to say, like, hey, this is messed up. Like, these situations are not justice. And that can be structural racism. That can be somebody calling somebody a slur on the street. And so to me, like, absolutely, like, society privileges white voices. I got to use my white voice to try to tear that down.
So you understand, as you know, I'm starting to learn about your privilege and my privilege as white men. And so that kind of, and then you also understand that we're all in it together, right? Or else you wouldn't worry about your privilege if it wasn't a team game, so to speak, a community game.
Sure, yeah.
How do you get other folks, other white men, especially white men, but any whites, to, number one, yeah, I have privilege, and number two, everybody matters, and to the extent somebody else is suffering, we're all being held back, roughly, I think, is probably, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth about that, how does that transformation happen then? What are you speculating? And that's why I want to tie back to Christina. What's your thought about?
Well, first, like you say, like you're saying, like, I understand my privilege. And I would say, like, I'm working to understand my privilege.
You
know what I'm saying? Like, it's like a lifelong thing.
We're recovering.
Right, yeah.
We are, right. I'll tell you a story in a minute about...
I'm a white male.
But I'm a recovering patriarch and racist.
Right,
and
right.
Yes. And I think that, you know, I understand anger. I think anger is justified. I think that there's a place and time for it. But I also think that, like, me being privileged means I'm not bombarded with the things that cause that anger every day. And so I can try to have a more, like, look, you know, like, you said this thing. Let me tell you about that. I mean, let's talk about how I feel, like, we feel about that. And, like, maybe, you know, maybe it gets to the point where I have to be like, absolutely not. But maybe I can start from a place like, look, dude, like, I know where you're coming from. I grew up in Middletown. I get it. You know, like, that kind of thing. But
you mean empathizing with another white person's anger?
Not anger necessarily, but like, you know, like, this not getting the privilege piece.
Yeah, okay, you know? Or frustration,
so like,
or...
Maybe I'm able to start from a place of like, all right, maybe you just don't understand. Maybe nobody's laid this out for you yet. And because, like, I'm not at risk the way, like, a person of color might be at risk, I can start by, like, let's try talking about this rationally first, you know? Like, and if that doesn't work, then, yeah, you got to be like, no, that's, you know, that's messed up. No, but... But you see what I'm saying? Like, I feel like that's something that I can do that is a little harder for someone who is, like, directly in the rays of, like, just terrible, ignorant stuff, you know? So that's, like, one role I see myself playing.
So did you say, inside of rational, did I hear empathy first, almost? Like, kind of understand where they're at?
I'm big on the idea of empathy, and I get why other people in this current state are not, and I totally respect that. You know, like, there are people who are done listening to some of the garbage that's being spewed. I'm on board with that, but, like, from my perspective where I'm at, like, my role as a person that I am, I want to go there first, you know?
Yeah.
So that's my personal answer, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I almost, with this whole Trump election, I heard from, of all people, Glenn Beck, right? It's like some, right? He's a recovering everything, right?
And he's in the early stages, but he is.
Well, he was very...
Coming to Jesus.
First of all, he hates Trump.
Yeah,
I don't know if hate's the right term, but he's like, Trump would be bad. Trump is bad on a lot of levels. Now, not necessarily conservative policy, but all that human stuff, he didn't like Trump.
And he's also owned his role in elevating folks who are supporting
those crazy voices.
Right.
So, and what he said that struck me was, and this, I think it was election night, because I don't think he'd won yet, but he said, if it goes this way, we all have to reflect on the anger in the white community that we missed and just empathize with where people are coming from first. And just like, how, because if they're so angry or desperate or whatever, that they're ready to throw a bomb or throw a grenade into the middle of our community and see how it goes, they're pretty desperate.
What's wild to me is people of color have not missed anything. So that's also, I think, what we
have. What's a missed? What are you saying?
So people are like, what did we get wrong, right? So
people of color haven't missed anything. Yeah, we have missed things.
Exactly. Right. So people of color have always been the canary in the mine. Right, so when America has a cold, people of color have H1N1. So if you look at Barack Obama, just his candidacy and the vitriol that was raised, him having to do his historic race speech in Philadelphia, right, that preceded even his election. And then you have people who were committed to obstructing any sort of political acts. But outside of that, I don't know if people remember, there were healthcare town halls being done throughout the country.
Yeah, I remember those.
And they were being interrupted by Tea Partiers, right? And Tea Partiers who had very distinct racialized views. The change of the House in 2010. So there's been indicators. White backlash is part of our history in this country. So whenever you get a wave of alleged progress for any marginalized group, there's usually privileged backlash. So it's a little frustrating to hear people sympathize with folks who are not, they're not all disenfranchised, for one. That's a misnomer. What's at stake here is the aesthetic of privilege and...
What do you mean by that, the aesthetic of privilege?
So there's this term that I learned recently called diminished overrepresentation, right? So the three of us could be disruptive to some people, because why is this black woman sitting with two white guys? diminished overrepresentation.
It feels good that you're sort of owning the room.
Right, but usually three white men would have the seat, right? So my presence is an attack on someone else's access to power, just aesthetically. Without any understanding of how I got here, what I'm doing here. Yeah. So it's just like, who gave you what belongs to me?
Yeah.
So I think in this moment, as we understand the politics of white anger and white fear, we also need to understand that white supremacy is inherent to these questions. We can't just say people have economic anxiety. The poorest people in this country are people of color. And they're in rural areas as well. They're dealing with heroin crises as well. And they're just not being seen. So I hope, and I don't believe it will happen, but I would think that people would look to say, hey, what did I miss? Since you're a person of color, and this election was clearly a referendum on multiculturalism, amongst a lot of things. Yeah. I just want to offer that, because it's been very frustrating to hear how people sympathize with angry white people, but they don't understand.
I want to be
angry
clear.
Black.
It's totally, and I agree with what Christina says. When I say empathy, I mean it more as like kind of a tactic that you use person to person, right? Like not trying to have like empathy or understand like this huge movement that happened with, say, Donald Trump. But like person to person, someone's going to, like, another white male who might be a Trump supporter is going to look at me and not immediately be like, oh, this is, you know, a person that I'm arrayed against, right? And in that is an opportunity for me to use the privilege that I have and whatever kind of thing they're going to do with my voice that they wouldn't do for a person of color, and kind of like get in there a little bit. You know what I mean? And I think that there are definitely some white men who will listen to another white man, and it, you could say the exact same thing as a person of color, and they're going to take it entirely differently. And that's what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about like, oh, we need to, because like, you know, the coalition that has elected Trump is Trump won people making more than $50,000 a year across the board. Hillary won everybody else. So that whole like argument about like the white working class getting Trump in office is skewed, and the empathy for the white working class isn't. That's not what this election's about. But you know, when I say empathy, I mean like on a person-to-person basis, I'm able to kind of keep my like my face straight, not get angry, and be like, let me try to break this down for you in a way that I'm not being condescending, I'm not being angry, because that might be the most effective.
And be with them, and just. It's acceptance and understanding and feeling their feelings without necessarily tolerating or approving of even implicitly the behavior or the attitudes, right?
It's like recognizing their human being, not accepting certain things from them. Like,
yeah,
I'm going to push you on that. If you say this, and this, or if I know you believe these things, I'm going to push you on that. But also, I'm trying to come to you from a place of disarmament. You know, like here right now, like let's just talk. You know.
So Christina, what? And I don't even know if this is an appropriate question. So you can say that and we can work backwards.
Sure.
What would you just examples of what white responsibility might look like? That you'd be like, well, that's good. I'm glad there's more of that, and that. Not saying that you're prescribing you all must do it that way.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if whites are taking responsibility for their shit, they will probably do it in the way that works for them. But what kinds of things would you be like, I know the right things are happening, that something has shifted because I see these things?
Yeah, so we're less than a week away from Thanksgiving. Right. And I've seen so many social media posts from white liberals are like, oh my God, I have to go home and deal with my racist family, and this is why I don't talk to them. You don't have the luxury to claim you're against racism and to disengage from your family members who have now reaffirmed the hellhole that we are entering, right? So you need to leverage your position regardless of how uncomfortable it is, and at its most intimate level. If you can...
At its most, like, that's where the leverage is, right? If family, even more than just a friend or even especially a stranger, you start where it's...
Right. So if you show up at a Black Lives Matter rally and you donate to showing up for racial justice, that's great. But if you can't talk to, you know, your sister about, you know, Fisher versus Texas and how people of color are just afforded opportunities that they didn't earn, then I don't need you. I just, at this point, there's an aesthetic participation that matters, but the grunt work, the behind the closed
aesthetic
door.
Aesthetic meaning showing up and like,
right.
Hey,
and I appreciate
I'm in a small group with African Americans.
Right. Kind of thing.
Right. Yeah. And I am limited. I have grateful, limited appreciation for it, but I need you to do what I cannot do. I need you to talk to the people that I cannot talk to, either because I'm not in proximity to them or because they won't listen. So unless you are taking responsibility for having an anti-racist table in your house, then you are not walking.
A little table tent.
You know what I mean? Like, because that's what the social segregation already exacerbates the limited understanding across races.
Right.
So if the people who are in relationship across those boundaries are not sort of conveying that message, like, hey, I know you are scared about, or you've lost an industrial job, but this is not okay.
This is what's real. This is
right,
what's not real.
Right.
This is
like,
where people, you know.
Yeah. You don't even have to be. I hate diminishing people's anger, because the anger is not just rooted in the right now. It's rooted in the historical, just continued marginalization and erasure. But I need white folks to grab a plate and while they're watching the Thanksgiving football game, talk about the North Dakota Access pipeline games and why it's not okay to wear a Redskins jersey. Like, it doesn't require much, but it does require something.
Well, what struck me about what you just said is it requires, almost is a prerequisite, discomfort.
Absolutely.
On the actor, the proactive white person's part.
Absolutely.
And I've been, my aunt, is a big Trump supporter, and the stuff she's been posting for 6 months, mm-hmm. and I'm just like, oh my God. Finally, she said something, posted something how Beyonce was like wiggling, and there was some meme that said, oh, something, and what kind of bad parents must the Obamas be, or what kind of values do they have if Michelle said that Beyonce is a role model for my girls? And I just said a very nasty reply. You know, if you're saying that the Obamas are a bad family, which I mean, just you take one look at that family, or observe for 8 years, you know, I couldn't even dog George Bush for being a bad guy, a bad parent. I mean, you know, his kids are fine kids, right? So, but the Obamas are amazing as a family. And it was a very nasty comment. And then, you know, of course, I had to apologize a couple days later when the entire family was buzzing about,
I can't believe you,
dropped an F-bomb to Auntie Carol. But what I realized, that actually wasn't helpful, because I didn't do the uncomfortable thing, which was, okay, like a week later, which now I am committed, I have to change. So you can email me next time.
Okay.
You want to, hey, have you reached out to your Auntie Carol to say, hey, I just want to talk about some of the things you were saying and have that hard conversation and not drop F-bombs, but also not let it go either.
Absolutely.
Right, so how can I be, like, she's my aunt, how could I still love her and have a challenging, a very uncomfortable conversation?
Right. And I think it begins, sometimes our instinct is to go with facts and percentages and counter articles, but it can really be as simple as a question, right? Like, so why do you think they're bad parents, right? Or, you know, what would make you post this? Or how do you feel about Trump's parenting, right? Like, he's married three times, right? Like, multiple children by different women. Often what happens is the absence of any sort of counter interrogation becomes consent, right? So, well, nobody has ever said anything about my Obama post before.
I never had to back this up before.
Right. So getting people to unpack, because we all become trapped in our cycles of cynicism and just oppositional thinking, because, you know, we all have our perspectives. So I mean, I commend you for, you know, walking off the ledge by dropping the F-bomb to Auntie Carol
was not productive.
But also committed to saying, I'm reflecting on this and I want to go back to the table.
Yeah.
Like, that's the work that needs to be done. Because there's only, I think what we're learning right now is there's only so much legislation can do.
Make sure that's on.
America tried to legislate itself into an anti-oppressive nation, but the hearts and the minds of individuals were still unchanged. So now we have to do that work while still re-energizing some of the policies that are going to be under attack or already are.
Yeah. So
as we speak,
Nick, have you been to Rethinking Racism?
Yes.
I would assume you've been to some.
I went to one in Mount Auburn, and it was great. Yeah.
Yeah, and I've been to two.
I think y'all were at the same one.
Maybe.
Mount Auburn. Yeah, I was there. Yeah. So I know I've been to at least two. I don't think I've been to three. I've had great conversations. I really learned a lot about systemic racism from the group I was in. I mean, I'm totally aware of what systemic structural racism is, but hearing from other African Americans, I said, "Whoa, that deepened my understanding."
Yeah.
But I was not having an uncomfortable conversation. I was not, if I weren't trying to challenge myself.
Mm-hmm.
To be uncomfortable in a sense, like, okay, what can I learn here that I don't already know? I don't know if I would have had that tense moment or that moment of being challenged myself to to dig deeper in myself. Like I would go to my aunt, like, well, who's coming to me? So, first of all, how is Rethinking Racism working on that ultimate, let's take a step back, where does it fit into this process of getting white folks like me with privilege to be uncomfortable in challenging other white folks? How is Rethinking Racism, how might it fit in? Is it working? Yeah. You know, what's its place in that process?
Yeah, I would say Rethinking Racism is interesting because it's a sort of choose your own adventure process.
Yeah.
So really the context of the conversation is determined by the people who attend. It's
right.
Not facilitated. It's just space and opportunity. So it can be very elementary or it can be very complex. I think when we started, what we didn't want to do is to be prescriptive. So it's beneficial in that way, to where I would hope, since you stated you weren't, you know, challenged, that you would be the challenger next time if you decide to show up. So what is it that you have grappled with? Maybe it's talking to your aunt about how racist
you know what?
They are. Maybe you host that conversation, right?
I'm remembering now the opportunity that I missed to be uncomfortable. See, and it's my responsibility.
Right.
Right? And I'm still in that, oh, well, what's Rethinking Racism doing? And that's the whole point you're trying to make is, like, no, what are you going to do to challenge yourself?
Right.
There was somebody brought up Tracy Hunter. Tracy Hunter would have been a great conversation because everybody's like, oh, Tracy Hunter's great, and she's been totally screwed. I, as an attorney, knowing a lot of judges down there still, a lot of lawyers down there, African-American judges, have a totally different impression of Tracy Hunter than like Cecil Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
And so that would have been a fascinating, but I wasn't willing to be uncomfortable in challenging sort of, like, I would have been the minority.
Yeah.
In that circle, and say, well, gee, that would be an interesting experience for me to have.
Yeah.
Like, wow, that, and I would have gained some real insight in, well, what if I were black in a circle of 10 whites pushing down? Well, now here I'm a white pushing back.
Yeah.
That would have been a really interesting experience for me.
Absolutely.
Interesting. And
yeah.
So what are your thoughts about, as I'm just sort of throwing this out there, you know, in response to this challenge to Rethinking Racism?
So with Rethinking Racism, I thought it was great. And I experienced a couple moments where I was like, oh yeah, you know, the thing I said was like, probably not the best way to put that. Or like, kind of like, you know, like I need to think about this more, you know.
But when you say not the best way to put that, you mean?
I just like things that were kind of like, either I was talking over somebody or I said something in a way that was like a little more authoritative and kind of like putting somebody else down, that kind of thing. Which is a more of a male thing maybe, but also I think a white black thing. So there's that. I also saw other people, especially white men, who are uncomfortable in our small groups. The thing that I think, I don't know if this is a good idea or not, but I mentioned
it. Literally, on Thursday. Yeah,
Is like, why aren't people like me facilitating Rethinking Racism in like Warren County? You know, like, why is that not happening? You know, like,
that uncomfortable.
Right.
Talk about uncomfortable.
Yeah, and like, it's something that, like, if there's a way to do it, I want to do it. You know what I mean? Like, that's where I'm at, because I think there is a lot of work to do here in Cincinnati. But there are also the people who are going to come to Rethinking Racism. It's
the white
liberals. Often going to be like,
sympathetic.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, right. Almost everybody there was, you know, we were all part of the same choir already.
Right.
Go ahead.
So if you can find a way to get it out to a space in Butler or Warren County, not to pick on those counties, but that's what I know, and that's, I know, the attitude's there.
Or to Indian Hill, maybe.
Or Indian Hill,
I don't know, or I'm just, you know, we don't want to pick on any particular community, but,
right.
You get further away from the urban core, Avondale.
Take a look at the map. Yeah.
Avondale doesn't need as many of these conversations as the other places.
Right,
first of all,
most of the folks that live it.
I'm in for that, you know, because that would be really, number one, it's the right thing to do, and it puts my money where my mouth is when it comes to race. But then also there's the professional side, right?
Right.
I mean, you know, I do a lot of, that's what I do, is I facilitate. This would be a great learning experience to really be in a hostile environment, and because that's when you got to be good.
Absolutely.
And you have to listen, and you have to empathize, and not react, and not use that, let your discomfort take you to bad places. So are you guys thinking about doing that sort of, take it on the road, or partner with you know, I don't know if you go and say, ask the local KKK to have a conversation. It might be right, that's too extreme, but what's that next? Yeah, that would be too much, but what's that next level of risk? Are you thinking of doing that?
That's a good question. We just wrapped up the final one for the year, so we're going to do some reflecting in 2017 planning. And just with the sort of, I don't want to say hopelessness, but there are a lot of people who are just heavy right now. So I think there will be a lot of a huge opportunity to sort of, you know, get out of the sobbing state that a lot of folks are in and do the harder work of engaging those communities that a lot of people claim they didn't know were angry. So yeah. I think that's a great call.
And I would just say that when it happens, and this suggestion coming from me is not saying like, why don't you guys go out to Warren County or something? Why aren't people of color taking this conversation to whites in Warren County? I'm saying like, why aren't people who have some awareness of this doing that? You know,
maybe you and I
should have done this about a year ago, probably longer.
Who knows where we'd be, but it's okay.
Maybe you and I should see if we can find, whether it's somebody you know in Butler County. I know a I'm going to put that just because I don't forget, right? Because, you know, we're talking.
Yeah.
This is where I keep track of my stuff. If it's important, I'll put it on my Saturday to do Nick on, and I'll get to hold of you through her.
I can give you my card, too.
Yeah, Butler County, and I'll remember what that means. Because I work a lot with Lakota Schools, and they're great.
This is,
You know, it's just, you know, there's a lot of great people out there, right?
Yeah.
But it's pretty conservative, and I'm sure that I could find a group to go out and do what we're talking about and facilitate a conversation. With people that might that would make us uncomfortable to have to push them a little bit. So let's loop back around because we should be doing that.
Exactly.
Not say, hey, would you call and set up some appointments for us, and then we'll swoop
on a
in.
Basis.
I'm a black person. Would you like to talk about racism?
We have some cool whites that would love to. Yeah. Right. Another question I have specifically about rethinking racism. So like I said, you know, and my guess is most people that go are looking to challenge themselves and at least to open themselves to something. So everybody's, and so I think it's awesome. Everything you're doing, you could change nothing and it's awesome. And just do more of the same would be great. So other than, you know, having that, you know, going to people and having those challenging conversations, whites to whites, is it possible that you guys might, in addition to the track of just open conversations in the open space where you create your own agenda, like you said, what did you call it? You said it was your, you used a certain term that was cool. It was create your own meeting, but it was...
Oh, create your own adventure.
Yeah, I like that. Create your own adventure. Create your own, you know, socio-racial culture adventure. So keep doing those, and maybe once every quarter do sort of an intensive, like Peter Block does, where say, hey, if you really want to challenge yourself, we've got somebody who's going to walk you through a process, and I'm just making stuff up, but I wouldn't know how to do this. Take the Harvard implicit bias test.
Yeah.
Confess, you know, to somebody.
Yeah.
Tell each other your stories. You know, really, I mean, whatever the process is, where it's there, you know, going in, you are going to get a deep dive of challenged on your racial stuff.
Absolutely.
The Power and Privilege series that David Weaver does would be really powerful.
Something like that. Yeah, right, where you could really take it, you know, that a bigger platform.
I think that's ideal.
Weaver would be great.
Look, we're big fans of David Weaver.
Yeah.
One of the challenges I've had as a just a black person that sits in a lot of conversations with well-intentioned white folks about race is almost too much liberty or lack of structural understanding for how things persist. So folks might well-intentioned adapt the colorblind sort of mentality and show up, you know, just want us all to come together because we're all red on the inside, we all bleed and we all love. That's great, right? But need you to understand the historical implications of how race was even created, how colorblind racism further perpetuates systems and behaviors that are unacceptable. So it is important to gather folks and to provide content and information that challenges their understanding of what needs to be done to address racism.
So the depth of, we can be, we're a little shallow potentially, a lot, not right. Just generally as a class,
yeah,
liberal whites, anti-racist whites, it's a relatively shallow understanding, like,
right.
Well, of course racism is bad, and it's, but we, yeah, but yeah. It, the
My
more we know the
racist,
depth,
right? Like everybody's racist except for you.
Right. So you're saying if we had a deeper understanding, that we would start seeing more of our own racism.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of like structural details that people, even well-intentioned like white liberal folks, don't know or understand. That once you know, then you realize that just being passively not racist is not.
Give me an example from either one, but maybe one from each that you have found like, wow, people's like, I didn't know that, and I'm glad I did because it makes a difference all of a sudden.
Well, I mean, when you think about why we live where we live, for example, you know, the whole like sort of like history of how that came about, the legislative and the sort of market forces and also the social forces that brought about our sort of like current pattern of residential segregation, which also is an economic segregation. Once you understand that, it becomes like very hard to not, as a white person who might want to own property someday, for instance, feel implicated in that. It's almost unescapable that you're going to be implicated in it. And you have to take responsibility for that. And unless you know that, like, unless you know that history, which starts, you know, with the start of the country, but in modern times, you know, in the 30s with redlining and, you know, with the GI Bill, billions of dollars to create white suburbs, you know, like, unless you know all of that, like, you're going to feel like, oh, if I just don't act racist, it'll be fine. And it's like, no, that's a little bit more than that.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Give me an example of one of those.
So I live in Walnut Hills. The neighborhood is changing. I'm the chair of the Redevelopment Foundation, so we have very frank conversations about how to retain people who are in the neighborhood while empowering them, while also increasing the economic diversity. And recently, Soapbox did an article about our school.
Yeah, I saw that. And they have a little very slick video on you.
Right. So Frederick Douglass is our neighborhood school.
Yeah.
Right. So Frederick Douglass struggles with retention for a multitude of reasons. Kids have housing instability, financial problems. And it's just segregated, it's racially, economically segregated. So we've had 30 new units built on East McMillan, and we've been talking to young parents about, you know, what do you want in a neighborhood school? Like, what would you need from a school to send your kid to Frederick Douglass? And it's been really interesting to engage in conversations with well-intentioned white girls about who their kids can go to school with, right? So
what has struck you about, you know, if they run through the whole litany, but what has jumped out at you from those conversations?
So,
because this is a low-income, largely African-American neighborhood school, and these are upper-middle-class whites saying,
right,
what would get them to send
love the diversity of the neighborhood, love their neighbors, love, you know.
But won't send my kids to...
Because they don't want their children to be an educational experiment, right? They don't want to potentially risk their child's inability to further excel in life. And if we know anything about how school funding works, we know that whenever a child leaves a school, funding leaves the school.
Right.
Yeah. So if we have people who move in the neighborhood, raise the tax base, but their kids are not going to the neighborhood school, the school is still going to suffer. So how do we call ourselves invested in equity across the board, but you're concerned about safety, the things that people who send their children to school are as well. So those are the sort of difficult questions that we need to ask ourselves. NPR, This American Life, did a great two-hour piece called The Problem We All Live With, and it's about racial segregation persisting in American schools 50 years after Brown versus Board. And it's like, unless we start saying we have to intentionally desegregate our schools by sending, because your kid can also afford amenities that other kids can't, right? So you can supplement with tutors, extracurricular activities, things that other children don't have. So if you're really, really invested in educational equity, instead of camping outside Fairview, you would send your kid to Douglas and assist in building up the infrastructure of that school too.
So would also apply the same pressure to the district you would apply at Fairview.
Right.
Know, this school needs to be good, you know? That's part of the buy-in is like,
yeah.
You know?
So I said the same thing before I had kids.
Right.
And then I had, when I had Oscar, you know, we live in East Price Hill and Carson would have been his neighborhood school. Mm-hmm. And our older daughter, who was like 8 years older, and she's tough. I mean, she is street smart. She has lived the street life since, I mean, really on the streets. All anything bad you can imagine about what a street thug is, well, that's the life my daughter has lived. She's 20 now and has paid a lot of different prices for that life. She couldn't handle Carson. She said it was just too rough, too, just everything. And said, she said, don't send Oscar there. She said, he can't go there. It's just rough. And, you know, and I don't know how much race comes with that. I certainly, a lot of class comes with that.
Absolutely.
I've coached my son's Price Hill baseball team, and it was all the, I mean, we had almost everybody on a scholarship. You know, folks that, everybody had to pay $10, but it was normally 75, and I said, well, can you do half? But almost every kid did 10. We had a third, basically Appalachian, but like very poor white, a third Hispanic, and they tended to be the wealthiest families. They worked construction jobs and all made good money. And a third low-income African-American kids in the neighborhood. And it was just tough. And it was just a there wasn't the same politeness or gentleness or something that he's getting at the new school Montessori up here.
Yeah, but there are kids who don't have that option, right?
I know. So my question, so let me ask you
this. So those kids are disposable. That's essentially the unintended message that comes along with that.
But what did those parents, so what I'm asking is, did any of the parents come out and say, I would not send my kid to Douglas as Douglas is right now?
Yeah.
And absolutely. What did they say they would have needed to see to get them to change their mind?
The things that are offered by the schools that they currently send their kids to. So warm, welcoming environments, lots of arts, after-school programs. Nothing that they were asking for was unreasonable. The issue is that when you can opt out, you are further exacerbating an already bad situation for those who can't. So that's the challenge.
I don't have
children, so I can't negotiate that. But I did go to all poor black schools my entire life. And it challenges me, particularly in Cincinnati, where people are really big on high schools, that we're okay with saying Walnut Hills is one of the best schools in the nation, right? SCPA is one of the best schools in the nation, but it's all right to let Carson fail. You know, like with all of these schools.
Yeah.
So what that requires, I think, is a sophisticated question. Perhaps you don't send your child there, but you start looking at PTA structures and funding mechanisms, but to disengage from them, which is often what happens, to leave it to those kids or those kids' parents, and then to wonder why we have cycles of high school dropouts or second in childhood poverty. This is all endemic of the greater issue.
Right.
Go ahead.
I think the people, the well-intentioned white liberals that we're all talking about here, the value system really needs to be like going to CPS and being like, okay, we have a couple of the best high schools in the nation. Why aren't they all that good? You know, like what needs to be done to make all these schools top notch? You know, like why does Carson fail?
Yeah.
And why do we warehouse some kids in some of these schools that aren't doing great? While others get to make a choice.
Yeah, they get to make a choice, go to the magnet schools, and then the worst of the worst will go where they go. Because
right.
Oscar's going to go to Walnut Hills, and so I don't look at as Carson is really a racial issue. One of the things I noticed from the baseball team, all of the parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles of the low-income white kids, they all smoked. Probably half of the African-American parents smoked. The level, I would bet money that if you measured percent of smokers at Carson versus, Fairview, I don't know, just whatever, just when you look at socioeconomic background, you know, the poorer you are, the more likely you are to smoke. The poorer you are, the more likely you are to be in trouble, to do drugs, to have addiction issues, to abuse your kids, I mean, all those different things. And so a lot of it was just the family behavior patterns. We didn't want to send Oscar there because he would be surrounded by that every day, day in and day out. So, and I'm just trying to be authentic. And,
yeah,
and I don't, because I totally get, to, like, God, I would love, and I certainly didn't want to pay the money to private school if he could have. It's like the modeling, right? What's he going to see every day?
Right.
You know.
And so to me, like, a lot of those behaviors we're talking about, or those family structures or whatever, are symptoms of intense economic distress and
yes.
racial distress, because
huge
we know that
economic distress.
Racially that. So my question is, why are all the kids who are experiencing that in the same buildings? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Why isn't it that we have the data, we know who it is, we know who these kids are. Why aren't they in equally dispersed across all these schools? Because we don't have a neighborhood school model exactly. We can send kids where we want. You know?
Yeah.
So that's my answer to that. You know?
So I just want to. What would you say to that? I mean, what am I missing? Challenge me in a way that, I mean, just because I struggle with this whole school thing. And I was like, back when I was in high school learning about busing, I'm like, of course we should have bused kids. Well, then busing takes kids out of their neighborhood and had all these weird effects. Not that the intention was bad. It's a hard issue. So what do you need to say to me?
I don't have children, so again, I can't speak to that. But I think so. I didn't. My mom did not have the option to send me elsewhere, right? So I went to a school similar to the one that you don't want to send your child to. I don't know. Like,
How are you feeling right now? Like, how does that make you feel? Like, here I am in my privilege. Well, I'm gonna send my kid somewhere else.
I
and
get
you
it.
Didn't get that option.
I completely.
But are you frustrated? I know you get it, but are you pissed off about that?
No, I'm not pissed off at you. I'm pissed off that those kids are left in a cesspool, right? And that people and it's really frustrating, particularly as someone who engages with white people who care, right? To know that she'll go tutor or read for 30 minutes a day, but then you'll get right in your car and you'll go right back. You won't make no sacrifice, right? Your kid will not have to walk through a metal detector if you don't want them to, or get frisked by a cop, when that is the day-to-day reality for so many people who grew up in circumstances like me. So I would lick. No school should be that way. But when you know it's that way, like, what is your responsibility? What is your obligation?
We'll get back to this whole about what whites taking some kind of action.
And I do wonder, because that's the other thing is, the white people tend to get a response of quality control that even organized black and brown parents don't get, even if they're middle class. So say you enroll your son and you show up like, hey, I'm Jeff, I'm a lawyer. I know you're here in your test scores, and this is, people know whose kids not to, like, not to discard or fall by the wayside. But people don't see poor parents or parents of color as actually opting into their children's education.
Yeah.
They see them as almost impediments to their child's education.
Right.
You know, they come from a family where they don't read at home.
And a lot of that, I mean, yeah, I think there's a fair amount of, like, pathologizing of poor parents that goes
on.
A lot of that is not necessarily because the parents don't want it. It's because being poor is exhausting, you know, and, like, being in that situation, you know, like, if you're facing these different challenges, you may not have the energy or the will or the belief that it's going to matter if you go to the school board and say, like, hey, my kid's school is fucked up.
A lot of it is, and not discounting anything else, but I know the belief part. If you've never been able to move the system,
absolutely,
right.
then the system says no, in whatever way that looks in that moment, it's really easy to turn around.
Right.
It said my daughter's just been in just hellacious trouble forever. And my wife would have to just, it's her biological daughter, so I wasn't literally allowed in the room most times. She would have to almost shout at and just be incredibly, the perseverance, like a bulldog, literally just grab onto the system and say, listen, you can't give me this dismissive song and dance that you give to all the other poor folks.
Yeah.
And she said, I know, and she would come home and say, I know now on a really deep level what poor folks are dealing with when the system blows them off, because the system is really insistent on blowing people off.
Absolutely.
I don't have time for that. And she would just, and she runs this place. She is a powerful woman. And so it wasn't like she would walk in because our daughter's all tatted up. Because she went to Carson, it's like, oh, you're just another one of those parents.
Mm-hmm.
And she doesn't wear a suit, she's here, so she's casual.
Mm-hmm.
And so she didn't get that, oh my God, there's a lawyer in a suit, dad, kind of thing that I might get. And it was brutal for her. And so I totally get that it would be very hard. So maybe one, I'm just brainstorming, to somehow just be friends with folks and offer to help with the system. Just talk to them about that. Just what are you going through?
So if you're not going to engage in sending your child, then you definitely need to become an advocate. So no child should have to experience. I'm sure parents that send their kids to school are as worried about their kid as you are.
Yeah.
What does it look like to continue to pressure the systems to be held accountable, even if you're not directly invested in one particular school? I guess what I'm getting at is what you're not expressing is indifference, it's trepidation, but trepidation can be as problematic as indifference, right? So to know that
it's the
these
same
things,
result, right?
Right, you're right.
If I'm nervous, if I'm afraid or uncomfortable doing it.
Right, yeah. So we have to, and we have to not, I love that you used the pathologizing. We have to not, we have to honor people's circumstances, even when they're challenging.
This one dad, and it was really a gift to coach. I did 3 years coaching this baseball team, and it was really a gift because I really got to know the parents and the kids. And some of the kids that, whether they were with mental health issues or just their diet, too much caffeine when you're 8 years old, and whatever the situation
processed
was.
Processed food, too.
Yeah. One dad is, I guess he still is, a heroin addict, chain smokes, the pathologizing that immediately happens upon meeting this person. Over 3 years, I got to know him, and he's got a good heart. And, the way he would talk to his kids, I'd just be like, But then I think, well, I talk to my kids kind of rough sometimes, but he was really a gift to these kids. And I just saw what he brought to the team. He was always there. Hey, I'll help, do this, do that.
Yeah.
And so I just started to see him not as a pathology or as a problem parent or as one of those at-risk parents. He just was... Ed, he was the parent. He was just one of the guys that came by, and we all worked together to do the best we could to help these kids. And I know my coaching style dramatically changed as I got to know the kids.
Good.
And just connecting with them rather than see the pathology was such a huge issue, which gets back to sort of where we started, which was, man, if we could just empathize with all those different folks over there, it starts to change whatever the responsibility action is. Anyway, just what are your thoughts about, as I'm sort of giving my thing here?
I mean, I think definitely empathizing with people who are experiencing a lot of economic or racial or whatever oppression is great. That's a step, but it's not the thing that needs to be done. The thing that needs to be done is speaking truth to the people that are, or the systems, let's say, that are oppressing those people. And
right.
And this is like,
it's a lot more comfortable than it is to empathize with the kids or the dads than it is to challenge.
I think it's great, and it's a thing that has to happen. We have to feel each other, right? But the feeling each other needs to be fuel for something else.
Right.
Something else needs to be banging on the school board's door, like, hey, you know, you can't do this to these kids.
Yeah.
That's my thought, you know?
Yeah.
It sucks. It's not sexy at all.
All these things go really long. That's why I need to turn this up, but I try not to look at the time. So we are over an hour, and, you know, people have a limited attention span, I think, and then it's editing.
Well,
as
I was going to say, 4 minutes of it is me blowing my nose.
So. Yeah. So
that'll be the teaser.
So just what struck you about this conversation? Just what are you taking away with you that is in any way that you can appreciate? Just this moment that we were together, you know, and got this time so just what are you walking away with?
First off, thanks for convening this and having this, you know.
Thank you for being here.
And thanks for being open, you know, like I feel like you were very open about everything, what you were thinking, and Christina, you're always open, and I love it. It's like one of my favorite things. I love that. You know, like I think there were some moments that were uncomfortable or felt uncomfortable a little bit, and I think that's good. You know, I think feeling discomfort is part of it, and a big part of it. So I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, thank you, Christina.
I appreciate you for speaking your truth, even though you know it might evoke some unsettling sort of reactions. That's important. And I always think it's important for people who believe in doing anti-oppression work to own their oppressive ideas and thoughts and behaviors. Because the system is abstract, right? But we're all products of something. So I appreciate that. I appreciate you for at least creating a vehicle to get folks to think about, you know, how we're all implicated, but how we're all, we can all be deconstructors of very complex issues. So thank you. Yeah. And we have a lot of work to do.
Yeah. Well, thank you for the thanks. I wasn't looking for that. but I do appreciate that. I'm feeling something, and it started when I posted on Facebook. I just was frustrated post-election at all the Trump is not my president protests, because I thought, well, geez, me and a lot of folks were saying, well, criticizing Trump, well, you can't not accept the election results. I mean, you know, it isn't, you know, he's everybody's president, and not that we tolerate any of the crap that he's going to give us, and we can see from some of his appointments, we're going to be getting some of that. In Juanita, Roberson, I was going to say Roberson, but Roberson, Juanita said, well, who are you to critique somebody else's protest? I said, well, it's just that it was the intellectual part of, she's like, no.
Technically, he represents all of us. Yeah.
Right, and is it less productive by then saying, okay, well, let's try to model what we would want from the other side if we had won, so to speak. And she said, listen, that's your privilege. And I said, well, nobody gave me the privilege. I'm just critiquing. And she said, well, that is the privilege.
Yeah.
And I realized that I give myself, nobody else gives me privilege. I re-understood understood what white privilege was, which was something that I take for myself, and I take for granted that I took that.
Yeah.
And what I took for granted and what I took is I'm going to criticize you guys for your protest, whereas when folks are that upset, and we're all upset, they're just expressing.
Right.
They need to express in whatever they need to express. And once they're done expressing, and that's the empathy piece. And just empathizing with where they're at, and then wherever it goes from there. But the start is just being with where they're at. And so something happened, and she worked me on three or four responses before I got it. And it just occurred to me, you know, like, I got it. And so it really sort of rattled me.
Yeah.
And so I'm feeling that same kind of a little discomfort, a little sadness.
Yeah.
Somehow talking to you guys. Not sad that I'm sad, but just like this.
This is the effect I usually have.
Yeah. Friday night.
Yeah. I don't even know what it is, I guess it's the vulnerability, and so if there's something, I'm trying to be more vulnerable and be more. And I think it's because I'm losing this privilege and just inviting, like, how fucked up am I? Tell me.
It's gift scene. He's being gift scene.
Oh, you know what I mean? Gift scene is here.
Yeah, what?
That's it's a long story. Outlet. No, so, but yeah. To your point, right, like, we romanticize revolution, right? So, like, oh, we can just get, you know, Trump out of office and give people $15 an hour and it'll all be good. Revolution is uncomfortable for all of us. There are things that we have to give up that we didn't even know we relied upon, even theoretically. So, like, am I willing to give up my car? What, like, would I be willing to live in squalor to make sure that all, like, these are the very difficult, complex
questions. Yeah, like that vow of poverty, right?
Like, you know? Yeah, like, these are the conversations that we have to have internally, that even the most well-intentioned, we still live in a very, the fact that we are even able to articulate our dissent right now on camera in a coffee shop, like, that's,
yeah.
It's, you know, we're afforded that opportunity. So I think it's important for us to always garner some level of, I don't know if it's discomfort or question. We should always be asking questions because there is no prescription to these very complex issues other than committing to them, committing to the people who are most impacted by it, and then committing to using whatever it is that we have to address it. So.
You know, I think I'm sad. There's like a disappointment in myself, right? For years of, you know, I went to Michigan, so you get pretty liberal pretty fast, and which is great. But somehow it just wasn't enough.
I don't know. You said you're recovering, right?
I think people in recovery, they have a lot of feelings. There's a lot of sadness for what was lost, for what wasn't, for like, wow. So I've been whole. I had this mantle of privilege, and I didn't even. So I think it's ultimately a sadness about what I haven't been in the world and could have been if I had only had all these veils. Like, how could I be almost 50 and just realize really what the definition of privilege and how it applies to myself?
Well, the fact that you are almost 50 sort of explains why that is, right? Because you were actually born into one of the bastions of white supremacy, like at its heightened, most visible state within this country. So the other thing is, not that I'm exonerating you as a white person, but I have to do this for myself.
We're not letting this off the hook, absolutely not. I mean, this is, I don't get, this isn't like a pardon.
I wouldn't expect anything less.
No, but we have to honor our shortcomings, because that also makes it worse. Whenever we become self-righteous and we're like, well, I've got this shit figured out, then we are doing the oppression in a different way. So we're colonizing spaces that don't belong to us, so we're trying to fix people, and people don't need to be fixed. Circumstances, systems do, but not people. People need resources, people need love, people need empathy, and if we can alter the environment in which they live in to give them the opportunity to realize these things that have been dampened by what we've all inherited, that's important. So it's okay to say, oh man, I'm challenged by this, and I don't know why. Because that means you're still learning, right?
And yeah.
That's important to struggle, I think.
Yeah. Well, you are a goddess.
Dang.
Really?
Yeah.
No, powerful women are goddesses.
Oh, wow. Thank you. Tell my mom that.
I agree with that.
Yeah. No, I mean, there's something, women are, you know, they're the embracers, the healers. Man, we're just going to keep colonizing, right? Just kind of in a maleness until we're all recovering.
Until we also learn to be healers.
Yeah, we're all recovering. Western men are almost all recovering patriarchs. Well, at the best, we're recovering patriarchs, right?
Yeah, I love that.
Whereas enlightened women are goddesses just trying to, you know, that's why Dan Joyner is very feminine like that. Those big hands. And he does it, Dan. If you want, no, really, he's just like, he does this real soft. Those big basketball hands. I could see him catching and doing his layups with these big, beautiful hands. Right? But now he uses them to facilitate.
Peter Block is very gentle.
Yeah, and Peter Block is very feminine in his way, though he's got his like patriarchy. And he says he's a recovering patriarch, and he's teaching the matriarchal model. Right. So thank you for being the goddess to us, and being wise.
You,
wise shaman, whatever role you want to, whatever label, I'm getting at all that stuff.
I'm putting it on LinkedIn.
So,
I'm doing it.
And you are a gift to the community.
Thank you,
Jeff. Thank you for writing about this and Going from barista to, you know, journalist, journal. What would you call it?
Award-winning journalist.
Progressive journalist, or what would be the title?
We'll just say award-winning journalist.
So you just leave it at that. Yeah,
sneak the progressive.
Yeah, right. Yeah, give it right. Don't tell them, or else they're gonna. Yeah, they're, oh, I don't need to read any more of that. Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, thanks a lot for being here, guys. I really appreciate it. So.
Awesome.
So we're done.
Sweet.
Cool.